Hello, everybody. I'm your host for today's lecture on optimization. We have Francis Bach today, and I'm very happy to introduce him. He needs no introduction, though, but like as a formal, Francis is a researcher at NDR, leading since 2011, the machine learning team, which is part of the computer science department at Ecole Normale Supérieure. He graduated from Ecole Polytechnique in 1997 and completed his PhD in computer science at UC Berkeley in 2005, working with Professor Michael Jordan. Then he spent 2 years in mathematical morphology group at Ecole des Mines de Paris. And later he joined the computer vision project team at India Ecole Normale Supérieure from 2007 to 2010. He is primarily interested in machine learning and especially in optimization, sparse method, kernel-based learning, computer vision, and signal processing. Well, of course, he has made tremendous contribution in the stochastic optimization method as well as like optimization in general as well. He obtained in 2009 a starting grant and in 2016 a consolidator grant from the ERC and received the India Young Researcher Prize in 2012, the ICML Test of the Time Award in 2014, as well as like Lagrange Prize in Continuous Optimization in 2018. Also, he won Jean Jacques Maury Prize in 2019 and recently in 2020 he was elected at the French Academy of Sciences. Of course, he had like won much more awards than this, but this was already like some. So now stage is yours, Francis. Yeah.
Okay, so let me share my screen. So can you see the screen?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So first, thank you, Anand, for the very generous introduction. And so it's a pleasure to teach at the Machine Learning Summer School today. I would have preferred a live lecture, but I think we're all happy that we can still go on a bit with a bit of science during those troubled times. So today I'm going to talk about optimization for large-scale machine learning. And the slides, I think they were made available this morning, but they're also on my webpage with a link below. So a tiny bit of context. I think I'm going to be quick there. So I think we have experienced the last like 20 years proliferation of data in all setups, like personal data, industry. But I want to convey the idea that there is life beyond Google and Facebook, and that in many sciences we see the appearance of data as well. Okay, bioinformatics, humanities, sometimes in places that we don't expect. For all of those, there is a need for automated processing of data, either to do better than humans or simply to cope with the sheer large amounts of data. So this has led to a series of hypes. Okay, so probably if you were already born, you may have learned about big data. Then people say data science. Then at one point they say machine learning, deep learning, now they say AI. At the end, it's a series of hypes, okay? And what I'm going to discuss a bit at the end of the lecture is a need to have some healthy interactions between theory applications and hype. So I'll come back to that at the end. This can be a nice topic for discussion. So yeah. All right, so what about the recent progress? So why are there some hype? I think classical, like very successful applications are in the natural language processing and computer vision. Okay, two examples which are very classical. And this is classically attributed to a combination of three factors. Okay, massive data to learn from, lot of computing power, and of course some scientific progress. So overall, the intelligence in quotes, okay, so you will not hear me again mention the word AI, is a combination of models, algorithms, data, and computing power, and the focus of today is mostly on the algorithmic part, okay, on the one part of the algorithms which are dedicated. And this is really the topic of today. And keeping in mind that all of those are important. Okay, so we need optimization, but this is really one piece of the puzzle and which I'm exploring today. All right, so what we're going to do today, we're going to look at mostly large scale supervised machine learning, where there will be two magic numbers, okay, D and N. So N will always be the number of observations we are learning from, And typically N is very large, okay, millions or billions. And D will be either the dimension of each observation or the number of parameters. So for linear models, those two are equal. But if you work with, let's say, neural networks, this is a bit different. And as I've mentioned, there's a lot of examples everywhere in computer vision, advertising, and so on. So advertising is very, very classical. I'm going to skip it. But computer vision, also very classical. And now there's very strong performance of algorithms. So this is like examples from colleagues at INARIA, where you can label like even like weird situations in images. But what I want to, again, emphasize is the fact that it goes beyond images and multimedia. And many of the techniques that people use for computer vision can in fact be applied to bioinformatics, where images are not the core focus anymore, but one typical focus is proteins, where you have lots of data to learn from, like millions of proteins. And every protein is quite complex. It can be seen in an amino acid sequence, or there's a link with DNA, and also a link with a 3D molecule. So although I'm not going to focus on any particular application today, I just want to remind all of us that there is many scientific domains which are in need of methods to do automated data processing. All right, so the goal of today is to look at algorithms to perform learning. And if you have N observations in dimension D, typically just looking at the data will take you O of Dn. And the goal of today is to obtain such complexity for our algorithms. So I think one core message is that we're going to go back to very simple methods. And I mean simple, like stochastic gradient techniques that date back from the 50s. And and this is the important idea in optimization. And many of the techniques that we use today end up being very similar. And the goal of today is to present both the classics and some recent progress. Okay, so there's a bit of both, looking at old things and the more recent things. So in terms of outline for the two lectures, I think this will be divided in three parts. And not exactly clear where I'm going to finish today, but the first part will be what is the introduction and introducing like the classical technique for optimization. And the idea here is not to provide like proofs of any kinds, but to give you like hints at the most important aspects. Then in the second part, I go over stochastic gradient techniques, and in particular the more recent ones. And I will go over two classes of methods, methods which are dedicated to minimizing the training error. That would be the variance reduction techniques, and the techniques dedicated to minimizing the testing error. Okay, so this will be important, and I will explain that better. And the second part will be mostly for convex problems. And then tomorrow, we'll go over like more recent work trying to get some form of guarantees for non-convex problems, typically related to neural networks. Okay, so this is the program for today. For today and tomorrow, and I'm going to finish somewhere in the middle. And just to Anand, when am I supposed to finish today? I forgot. It's like at 10:30. Okay, so I will assume 10:30 unless you say otherwise. So in terms of questions, I think we agreed with the host that I may pose at some point, which are appropriate to allow questions. So I think you can put them on the chat and I will try to look at them and answer questions. All right, so let's start. So I'm going to consider parametric supervised machine learning. I'm going to consider observations XI, YI. XI can be an image, YI can be a label on that image, and I observe N of those observations, so N pairs XI, YI, so N typically quite large. And the goal is to predict a new Y given a new X. And this is typically done through some prediction function, H of X and theta, two parameters, X your input data point, and theta your parameter, typically in R. So as I've mentioned, there are two main classes of models that people typically use. You have like linear models, which are well adapted to very large vectors, like in advertising, where you learn from your navigation history, so which you code as a big sparse vector for every website, zero if you have never been there and one if you have been there. So here the n is the number of clients of those search engines. And typically you combine them linearly, okay, where theta is a huge phi of x is typically sparse, but theta is typically a huge, dense vector. Okay, so this is still used quite a bit. So advertising partially, but also in many areas where the number of observations is not super big. Okay, this is still like, there is still a lot of problems where simple models still work pretty well. But if you go in areas like computer vision or natural language processing, then, and this is an example from computer vision, where you have images as input and labels as output, then typically the models that are the best performing at the moment are neural networks, where you have some, you start from X, you apply some linear function of X, theta one, but then you apply some nonlinearities once, then you start again, okay, and then you remultiply by some linear function and retake nonlinear function, and at the end you get like a neural network with various number of layers. And so in this talk, the first part I will mostly focus on linear models, because this will lead to what we call convex problems. All right, so to fit, to find the parameter theta, typically people minimize the regularized empirical risk, which is composed of a data fitting term like this. You average over your training data some loss, okay, between what you want to predict, yi, and your prediction function, h of xi theta. And you add some regularizer for various reasons. The most important one is that you want to avoid overfitting. So you want to make sure that you generalize to unseen data. So what about losses? So I'm going to be brief, just to remind you of the classical losses. This is more like material from MLSS 2005, but I think it's still important nonetheless. So if you do regression, then typically the square loss is typically used. Whereas if you do classification where your label is -1, 1, then the prediction is done by taking the sign of your prediction function. And then you have to define a loss, okay? And typically you can quickly realize that if you take the product of your label times your prediction function, if this product is positive, you make no mistakes. And if this product is negative, you make a mistake. So the 0-1 loss, the one that you report in your paper, is typically, this is a blue curve over there, okay? So it's a function of the product y times the h, but it's a non-continuous, non-convex, so it's hard to optimize. And again, so what learning has been doing for quite a while is to replace that 0-1 loss by so-called convex surrogates, which are convex, okay, and which try to mimic as much as possible the behavior of the 0-1 loss. So you see the square loss in blue like this, turquoise, and which is ignoring the fact that y takes only two values, but still efficient, works reasonably well. You have the logistic loss in green, which is like now very commonly used, whether you do like linear models or neural networks. And in green and blue, no, red, sorry. In red, you have the hinge loss, okay, which is related to the support vector machine. Okay, so here the loss. So why I'm presenting those losses? Because typically some properties, you have some different properties depending on the loss. Okay, for the hinge loss, so it's a formula for the hinge loss, so you get a max function, and it's a non-smooth function because of the kink at one. And today I'm not going to talk about non-smooth functions. So it's mostly to mention that there's an area of machine learning which deals with non-smooth function. It's important, but I'm not going to cover it today. And what I'm going to cover today is mostly smooth problems. So logistic loss like this, and of course the least squares. So here I'm giving just examples when the output is one dimensional, but there is a large area of work where you want to predict things which are beyond binary or real outputs. And there's a very nice area of structured output regression. And essentially, from my point of view, when I take my hat of an optimizer, it just replaces the loss by something else. And throughout the talk, I'm going to assume the loss is smooth and convex. So very important aspect is that all the losses I'm going to consider are convex in the second variable H. Okay, that should be a comma here. And so this is not a strong assumption. Okay, so the strong assumption would be linearity of H with respect to theta, but convex loss, this is what is used even in deep learning. All right, so in terms of regularizers, it's not like a talk about regularizer. So I'm going to mention the classical two types. So you have Euclidean norms, so typically the squared Euclidean norms, and this is related to kernel methods. I don't know if you have a class on kernel methods, but if you don't, you should look like at the nice book by Bernard Chokov and Alex Smolar and others. And so I'm not going to cover it, but I think it's important nonetheless. And you have the other type of regularizers, which are L1 norms. Okay, typically L1 norms, where the goal is not only to avoid overfitting, but to add some extra behavior, typically feature selection here, because of the non-smoothness of the L1 norm. So I'm not going to cover regularizers today, but the take-home message is that if you have the Euclidean norm, because it is like smooth and nice, okay, the square function is a smooth function, quadratic smooth function, typically you can simply do as if you had no regularizers in terms of optimization, take gradients and so on, it's easy. Whereas for those norms, where it's a non-smooth function, typically you should deal with them with so-called proximal techniques, where you take a gradient step, but you add some thresholding on top of it. And if you want to know more, I've written some tutorial about it. But it's really not the topic of today, but keep in mind that if you add some non-smooth norm into your problem, this can be dealt with easily. All right, let's go back to the problem. So what are the goals? So the goal is really to minimize that function. And the only property that we're going to leverage throughout the talk is the fact that we have a finite sum. Okay, so machine learning is not any optimization problem. It's minimizing a finite sum. Okay, so what has been done originally. So if you're going to MLSS 2005, you will see like methods dedicated to optimizing any function, okay? And today is really focusing on minimizing averages of function. So there are two tasks that you want to solve for that problem. The first is pure optimization. Okay, so you give me that objective function. I want to minimize it as hard as I can and as precisely as I can, but I don't care so much about what the optimizer theta hat will do, okay? And what theta hat will do is more a focus for statistics, okay? So the idea here, and I'm caricaturing here, is that statisticians will not care so much how you find theta hat, okay? They ask their friend optimizer, but they care about making sure that it does generalize to unseen data, okay? And as soon as you see, as you say, I see some data and there's data that I don't see, you have to make a link between the data that you see, the xi, yi, and data that you don't see, which is the distribution at test time. And often this is made through like a classical distribution assumptions. You assume the data come ID from a given source, okay? And you assume the source that you had for training time is the same as what you have for testing time. Okay, so this is like two fields in itself. And the main topic of today is really to, if you want to deal with large scale machine learning, you should like do the two at the same time. Okay, so optimization is just a mean to an end. We don't care at all about minimizing this. We care about minimizing the test loss. All right, so let's go down to the classical assumption I'm going to use in this lecture. I'm going to be very non-technical. Compared to typical optimization papers, I will try to remain as non-technical as possible. So as I've mentioned, I want to focus on smooth problems. Okay, so on the left, a smooth function, okay, no kink. On the right, a non-smooth function with a kink over there. So the way to characterize it in mathematical terms, is to look at regularity assumptions on our problems. And so here, we're going to assume the function is differentiable two times, and that the eigenvalues of all Hessians are bounded. Okay, so typically the Hessian is a symmetric matrix, D by D matrix, and you want all the eigenvalues to be bounded by L. So if you prefer, the Hessians have to be bounded. Okay, so this is really what you should have in mind about there. So for machine learning, this is quite a weak assumption, in the sense that if you have some smooth loss like logistic, and if your function h is smooth in theta, you end up with a smooth prediction function. Okay. And just to make things concrete, I'm going to go to the board, but I have no board, so I have a fake board as a slide. I'm going just to do the math briefly for the linear models, because I think it's important to understand, to have a clear idea of how it looks like for linear models. So this is the usual average over my training data of the loss and some linear model, so theta transpose phi of xi. So if I take the gradient, so I can take the gradient of each piece separately by linearity. And here, L prime is the derivative with respect to the second variable. Okay, so this is a real number. So when you take the gradient, you get also a real number. And because this is a function only of the linear projection, the gradient will be proportional to the feature vector. Okay, so this is, this will be important later on in the talk. That's why I mentioned it. So this is a gradient. And if you take another derivative, you get the Hessian. And again, you see the real number, okay, which is the second order derivative of the loss, and times now rank one matrix. So this is a matrix of size D by D, which is rank one. And now if the loss is a smooth, so this is L second is bounded, then if your data are bounded, then you get some bounded loss. Okay, so it's really, really simple here. Of course, if you were to take neural networks, that would be a bit more complicated. But if you have a smooth activation function, you will get like similar things. All right. So this was one assumption of eigenvalues that they are bounded. Okay. And now I'm going to mention like the convex assumption, and the idea here that the eigenvalues are bounded from below by zero. Okay. So on the left, the usual convex function, okay, always above all of its tangents. And so this is, and we're going to consider also strongly convex, where not only your eigenvalues are non-negative, but are really strictly positive, and you have a lower bound everywhere. So here, what is important is that this bound is uniform over all theta. So for all your parameter vectors, you get some minimal eigenvalues. So why is it important to consider those eigenvalues? Because locally, if you're twice differentiable, your function will look like a quadratic function. And the eigenvalues will tell you how the level sets look like. So because, I'm assuming like a convexity. So the level set looks like ellipsoids. And the eigenvalues will tell you if the ellipsoids look more like on the left, like a nice ball, or if the ellipsoid is quite elongated over there. And so this is dictated by the ratio of eigenvalues. So of course, in 2D, there are only two eigenvalues. Okay, so essentially, L is the largest eigenvalue of the Hessian, and mu is the smallest eigenvalue of the Hessian. So the kappa here, which is L over mu, is always bigger than one. And this is called the condition number. And when the condition number is small, then your level sets will look like balls. Okay, and where the condition number is large, then you have some areas where the function does not move so much. So in 2D, it's of course, you always have some, like your ellipsoid cannot be too elongated, but if you're in dimension 1 million, you have many dimensions where the ellipsoid is very flat. So this is really an important image to have, is that on the left, a well-conditioned problem where things will be easy to optimize, on the right, some harder problem. All right, so what about machine learning? Do we have convex functions? Okay, so the first, if you take our preferred problem over there, so a sufficient condition, which is almost necessary, is that you have some convex loss. And again, a convex loss is a weak assumption. Like everybody uses a convex loss. Almost everybody uses a convex loss. And but now you need to assume that you have some linear predictions. Okay, so why? Because you get a convex function of a linear function and you remain convex. And so this is now a strong assumptions. Okay, so this only applies to linear models. So this being said, what is the relevance of convex optimization beyond like learning linear models? So I think the first one is easy to design and analyze. So if your preferred optimization technique does not work for convex problems, okay, where the issue of global minimum versus local minimum is not an issue, I think you're in bad shape. Okay, so this is really the first thing to understand that if you end up, if you have a convex problem, does it really work? So once you go non-convex, okay, so it's known that you have this issue between stationary point and local minima and global minima, because typically all the techniques that we use, which are gradient based, will get stuck at a stationary point where the gradient is equal to zero. And so when you transfer convex to non-convex, so the first hand waving argument is to say that locally, when you're around the optimum, you're like locally convex. Okay, this is one argument. But to me, the real argument is that it has to work for convex problems at least. And what is important as well is that convexity, okay, for the thing that we need to consider today, sometimes that's just here for analysis. If you start to need convexity to design the algorithm, for example, if you do convex duality, then this will never extend to non-convex problems. But if you start with a formulation where to define the algorithm there is no need for convexity, then you're in good shape. And gradient descent is one example of that. So you study it for convex problems. And in most cases, all the guarantees that I'm going to present today about a global optimality, I'm going to say that gradient descent after T steps will be like a function of T away from the global optimum. You can translate them in the non-convex world by the gradient, the norm of the gradient. Okay, so yeah, there's a nice line of work extending the classical guarantees for convex problems to guarantees to convergence to stationary points. Okay, I'm not going to mention it, but I think there's one slide where I mention it. But keep in mind that convexity in most of the talk is just here as a tool for analysis and is not required to run the algorithm. So if convexity is a strong assumption, strong convexity is even stronger. Okay, and so typically for that, you need a strongly convex loss like least squares, and of course also linear predictions. And let me look at the board now. Okay, so take my preferred like function, okay, loss with linear predictions. Then there is the gradient that I've mentioned earlier. Then there is the Hessian, okay. And for simplicity, I'm going to consider the square loss. For the square loss, then the Hessian, the second order derivative is constant. So I get one here. And what I obtain is that the Hessian is exactly this matrix, which is a non-centered empirical covariance matrix, and which is like the covariance matrix of your feature vector. Okay, so this is a D by D matrix, which is obtained as a sum of n rank one matrices. So now we look at the eigenvalues of that matrix. Okay, and so to be convex, we need that to be non-negative eigenvalues, which is always true. Okay. But if you want all eigenvalues to be strictly positive, then this matrix has to be invertible. So this means that as a sum of rank one matrices, then n has to be bigger than d. Okay, so this means that if you want to hope for a strongly convex problem, you need n to be larger than d. Okay, so this sometimes is true, sometimes it isn't, because sometimes d is very large, in particular in those big sparse vector problems, a sparse feature problem, D is like billions. Okay, you have a big sparse vector. So what's really important is that you need this invertible covariance matrix, so n has to be very big. But it's only part of the story, because if even n is bigger than d, this is just telling you that if you want to hope to be strongly convex, you need n to be bigger than d. But this does not mean that that for all problems where n is bigger than d, you're going to get some strongly convex problem. In particular, if you take if two features are carbon copy of each other, okay, then mu is zero. And in more data sets, so you can take your favorite data set when n and d are very large, you can try to compute the eigenvalues of your covariance matrix. This will take you quite a while. And if you do that, you will realize that the smallest eigenvalue of the covariance matrix is either zero or something which is very small. And when I say very small, I think of 10 to the minus 12 small, okay, something which is very large. So this means that most problems in machine learning are not naturally strongly convex. Okay, so this is like well known, and so typically we make them strongly convex by adding some mu over 2 times the square norm of theta. Okay, so this norm would be the square Euclidean norm, okay, the sum of the square components. And now if you start from a convex problem, if you add this function, you make it strongly convex. Okay, so it's and now you control the mu. Okay, so the take-home message here is that typically the strong convexity coming from the loss, from that part, you can assume it's almost always zero or very small. And the strong convexity typically comes from the regularizer. But if you add some regularization so this is often to avoid overfitting and also to help optimization. And you see here that the optimization and statistics are quite well aligned. This is a very common theme, that what typically is good for one is good for the other. But now you should realize that the mu has to be small, okay? Because if I can take mu very, very large, this is going to be very, very easy to optimize, but lead to a very small theta, which is totally useless, okay? So mu has to be small and typically will decay as you get more data, okay? So there is typically many arguments to from learning theory telling you that mu should be between n, 1 over n and 1 over root n, okay? Of course, times l, okay? So mu has some dimension, so it should be the same dimension as l. And the ratio typically is between n and root n. So condition numbers in machine learning typically are large when n is large. Okay, so if you have a billion data point, then the condition number will be very large, because this is a very particular type of problem. And this very large condition number could mean this is hopeless, but we're going to leverage the finite sum structure to get to nice algorithms. All right, so now I'm going to look at the classical techniques for minimizing smooth functions. Okay, so here I'm going to assume convexity mostly so that the results I'm going to present are valid. But if you remove convexity, then results are still valid, but with some modifications. All right, so what is gradient descent? This is an old algorithm dating back from Cauchy in the, I think, 1841, 1842. And the idea that you go down the negative gradient. So on the left, you start from a point over there and you follow the gradient, which is orthogonal to the level sets. Okay, and then you follow it for a while, then you stop and you follow it again for a while like this. Okay, as you can see, you will oscillate, okay, more if you're in condition and less if you're well conditioned toward the global optimum. So of course, the key issue is how you set up the step size, gamma t. So there's like many ways of doing it. So line search typically is possible there if you can compute the values of g and its gradient exactly. And this is typically done in practice, various ways of doing line search. You can do like exact line search like I'm been doing this in those plots, okay? But typically like approximate line search or even constant step size is often sufficient. Okay, as you can see on the left, you converge like in a few iterations. So here you do oscillate a lot because of this elongated ellipsoid, you end up going back and forth following the valley up to the optimum. So this can be characterized with the precise convergence rates. Okay, so here the big O I've put the big O's like constants, which I don't want to talk about, but there are like formal results with all constants. Okay, so this is one very nice contribution of optimization in the last 20 years is to come up with what we call non-asymptotic guarantees, which are totally explicit. Okay, so this is something which is important, which I will not focus too much on today to remain simple, but you can have like the big O's can be all explicit and they won't take you like two lines. Okay, it's very compact. Right, so what we so those oscillations can be characterized, and this is where the condition number comes in, is that the we obtain what we call linear convergence, so exponential convergence, where the time, the excess between your value of g at time state t minus the optimal value goes down to zero as a geometric sequence, and the mu over L is characterizing the rate at which you converge. Okay, so if mu over L is very small or kappa is very large, then this exponential convergence is exponential, but the factor is very small. Okay, so if mu is 10 to the minus 12 compared to L, then you do get linear convergence exponentially fast, but this is going to be very slow because typically to see an effect when you have linear convergence, you need as many steps as the inverse of that constant. So to see an effect of exponential convergence, you should have the number of iterations should be of the order of the condition number. So if the condition number is 10 to the 12th, you're never going to see it. And that setup, you're more or less in the convex setup. You think you're strongly convex, but mu is so small that you cannot see it in practice, or mu is zero. And then you go back to this one-over-t convergence rate, often called sublinear, which is, of course, much worse. And this is, you have oscillations, but those oscillations will end up converging. So it's a global convergence proof result, but you get to be much slower. Okay, so this is, and I will come back to that later. And that those pictures, those the fact that you have a slower rate over there and over there, there is not much you can do about it. Okay, so there's a, what we call lower bounds, saying that if you want to minimize a function which is simply a convex and L smooth, okay, you will be, you can beat those algorithms. This will be done by Nesterov acceleration, which I will mention later, but it cannot be beaten like a lot. So in the sense that some problems are hard, like this one, some problems are easy, like this one, and it's not the fault of the optimizers if the algorithms are slow or fast, okay? It's because it's the problem of the person giving us the problem. If we're being given some hard problem, there is not much we can do about it. We can do our best, but if it is too slow, it's sometimes not our fault. Okay, so I'm trying to defend the optimizers over there. All right, so of course, so this is what's important is that when you design some optimization problem, you should try to make it as easy to optimize as possible. And this is why I think it's important to consider both optimization and statistics at the same time, because you can have the control on what you do. So hopefully design a problem which is easy to optimize. All right, so the proof of, that, of those results, I'm not going to go over the proof. I'm just going to mention the simplest case, and because I think it gives a good insight on what's happening. And the simplest case is a quadratic contact function. Okay, so we have like a quadratic term, so a linear term. And over here, so the smoothness constants L and the strong convexity constant mu are just the smallest and the largest eigenvalues of the Hessian matrix, which is constant because it's quadratic. The global optimum can be obtained by setting the gradient to zero, because the gradient is h theta minus c. If you set to zero, you get this equation, it's a linear system, which you can invert to obtain theta star. Well, so what is gradient descent? So if I take a constant step size for simplicity, so this is my gradient descent step. This is the gradient of the function over there, okay? H theta minus c, okay, taken at theta t minus one. So this is the gradient descent step. I know that c is h times theta star, which I replace over there. And what I see is that if I subtract theta star over there, I subtract theta star over there as well. And what I obtain is that to go from step t t minus 1 to t, I'm simply multiplying my deviation to optimum by a constant matrix, which is the identity minus 1 over L times H. Okay, so at the end, I get a linear recursion in terms of matrices. Okay, so if I have a linear recursion, I can unroll the recursion and apply it t times, and I get the power t of the recursion matrix times my initial deviation vector. Okay, so here, why quadratic functions are very nice, because you can explicitly give the formula for the gradient descent algorithm. And because I have the power of some matrix, and that matrix is symmetric, because H is a symmetric, it's a Hessian matrix, so it's symmetric. Then I can decompose into eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So essentially, I'm going to act on every, I'm going to put myself in the basis of eigenvectors. And on each eigenvector, I'm going to simply multiply by the corresponding eigenvalues. So the image to have when you do optimization is that among all eigensubspaces, I'm having different speeds. So when the eigenvalue is very large, so this one minus this will be very small. So I'm going to contract a lot. Okay. Whereas if the eigenvalues of H is very small, then I'm going to not contract a lot. I'm going to be very slow. Okay. So in some directions, I'm very fast. And some directions are very slow. Okay, so it's really a good image to have is that, and of course, you don't know in advance which direction is which. Okay, so this is what makes it difficult. So now if you can derive bounds, so if you look at the eigenvalues of that matrix, and the eigenvalues of the power is just the power of the eigenvalues, so the eigenvalues of identity minus H over L is simply between zero and mu over L. So you get this largest eigenvalue of that matrix. So since your deviation to optimum is something like that, then the square distance, okay, is also shrunk by the largest eigenvalue of your matrix. And this is essentially this largest eigenvalue. And you see appearing this one minus mu over L power two T, which is the height which I was presenting earlier, and is obtained in very, like in two lines of computations. Okay, so to get the insight on where the 1 minus mu over L comes from is very direct. And if you want to get functional values, you can get similar things, but I'm not going to do it. Okay, so it's really I like to look at quadratic functions because it's even simpler. Okay, and everything can be done in closed form. All right, so now if you take this and take mu equal to zero, this is still true. Okay, but if mu is zero, so this disappears and you get like, you just get that the distance to optimum is not increasing, which is good, but it is not enough. And you obtain this, and what you can show is that you do get convergence nonetheless. So let me go down to the board. Okay, so there is no convergence of iterates, as I mentioned. But now you can look at the distance to optimum in terms of functional values. This is very like a subtlety in optimization. Sometimes we measure distance to optimum through theta t minus theta star, and sometimes we measure it through the value of theta t minus the value at theta star. Okay. So typically, this is adapted to situations where theta star is unique, okay? Because if you converge to theta star, then this means that theta star has to be unique, essentially. And whereas if you don't have unique optimum, then you better use this, okay, which should converge to zero. And if you just convex, theta star may not be unique. So it makes sense to use that as a criteria. Okay, so now, since you have a quadratic function, okay, you can do a Taylor expansion of G around theta star. The first order, zero order term is zero because I've subtracted it. The first order term is zero because the gradient of G is zero. And I only end up with a second order term. And it's very classical that the distance to optimum for quadratic functions will be a quadratic form with the Hessian matrix, which is over there. Okay. So now if I replace this by the expression of theta t minus theta star from previous slides, I obtain this formula, okay, which is compared to before, I just added an H. Okay. And so here I have a very similar problem as before. is that I'm going to look at every eigenspaces spaces separately and see how much I shrink. Okay, so I'm going to do trying to maximize over the spectrum of H, okay, and the gamma is 1/L over there. So I'm going to maximize for every eigenvalue V of H that expression, okay, and hopefully this will be small. So what has changed compared to before is the appearance of that small H over there and that V over there. Okay, so what this means is that if I didn't have an edge there, then I will only rely on the exponential behavior. So when edge has some small parts, I will not contract. Okay, but now that I add edge, if edge is small over there and I don't contract, anyway, it doesn't count so much because I don't move so much along that direction. Okay, so if I don't contract a lot because of that term, this will be sent to zero because of that term. Okay, so essentially, I need to make sure that this is bounded. Now you do like standard like algebra. So you bound one minus u by the exponential of minus u. So very standard bound of the exponential using convexity of the exponential at zero. And then you put in the two t inside the exponential. You get something like this. And now you try to make appear that term on the left. Okay, so you have a term over there and the same term over there. But to do this, you have to add like L over 2T. Okay, and now you realize that here you have some number, which I will call alpha, times the exponential of the same minus the same number. Okay, and this turns out that the function alpha times exponential of minus alpha. Okay, so I don't know if you see me, but at zero, it has zero, it goes up and then goes down. Okay, and so you can compute the maximum of that one-dimensional function. I think it's 1/E. So at the end, you end up that this quantity is always bounded by a constant divided by t. Okay, and this is what I was promising, that 1/T convergence friend. So here, it's good to remember is the fact that this is obtained by counterbalancing the lack of contraction by the fact that in the contractions, in the directions where I don't contract, I don't care so much about the variations. Okay, and this is the trade-off is really like settled with the constant 1/T. So how to do it? Sorry, beyond quadratic functions. Okay, so this is more technical, but you get to almost the same results, okay, up to some constants. Okay, so of course you cannot have closed form anymore. Okay, so you have to rely on more refined tools, but this is possible as well. All right, so this is the summary for gradient descent. So regardless of machine learning, it's any function g which is convex, okay, coming from machine learning or not, you get 1/T if you're just convex, and exponential of minus t over kappa if you're strongly convex. All right, so this is not the only one. Okay, so if you take some class in optimization, okay, then you probably have seen like a Newton method, which is something of that form. So where does it come from? So Newton method comes from a second order Taylor expansion of your function. So around theta t minus one, you approximate your function g by the constant term, the linear term obtained from the gradient, and the quadratic term obtained from the Hessians. Okay, so you just have a quadratic, which is tight at theta t minus one, both for the function value gradient and Hessians. And now, classical idea in optimization, you take a model of your function and you minimize the model. And if you minimize the model, it's a quadratic model. So you can take the gradient. And the gradient of this is simply that. So this is the gradient of this is this. So the gradient of this one is this one. And if you set it to zero, you end up with the linear system, which is a Newton, system over there. And so on the positive side, this goes now much quicker. It's called like local quadratic convergence in the sense that if you're close enough, this is a local aspect. If you're close enough, at every iteration, you take the square of the previous error. Okay, so if you take the square, it goes very quickly to zero. But the downside is that you have to solve that linear system, okay, which is typically difficult just to form because it's a D by D matrix, and it may take quite a while to minimize. Okay. All right, so this is a summary of those two algorithms, which are very classical in terms of number of iterations. Okay, so here I'm doing a lot of, I'm going to do, go back and forth between precision as a function of t to number of iterations as a function of precision. Okay, so if I put epsilon being exponential of t minus kappa, then if you invert this relationship, I get that t, number of iterations, is kappa log of 1 over epsilon. Okay, so I'm going to do this for quite a while in this talk. And for the quadratic convergence rate, okay, so taking square of the error end up with the power t over there. And if you invert the relationship, you get like a log-log dependence. Okay, so if you're looking for problems where epsilon is very, very small, okay, you want to get machine precision, okay, so this will be still quite big over there, and this will be tiny here. Okay, so often Newton technique is very adapted if you want to get machine precision. But in fact, I'll show later that you can also achieve it with the good techniques, nonetheless, which are still only depending on the gradient. But of course, if you start to factor in the complexity of each iteration, okay, it's a bit different. So as I've mentioned, if you do machine learning with like n functions with a parameter which is d-dimensional, then this is the cost of computing a single gradient, because you have to sum all gradients of all functions, it's O of nd, times the number of iterations, whereas for Newton technique, the basic complexity to solve the linear system, you have to form a system, typically nd squared, because you have to sum n functions of size d by d, and then you have to invert the system, typically d cubed in general. All right, so this was for all functions, but now we want to do machine learning. Okay, so if you do the machine learning, there are a few key insights which are nicely laid out by Léon Bautou and Olivier Bousquet. The first one is we don't need epsilon to be that small. Okay, we don't need to optimize below the statistical error. So what do I mean by this? Is the fact that our functions are averages. So if you take averages of random variables which are independent, then these averages will, by the law of large number, be close to the expectation, and by the central limit theorem, will tend to deviate from that expectation with a standard deviation of the order of 1 over root n. Okay, so by design, what you optimize is only true up to 1 over root n. So it's kind of useless to try to minimize it with epsilon below 1 over root n. And before 1 over root n gets to machine precision, okay, we still are far away from this. Okay, so even Google does not have like that many data points. Okay, so epsilon typically is very far from machine precision. First aspect. Second aspect, our cost functions are averages. Okay, so in the techniques I presented earlier, there is no use of any kind of the fact that we have finite sums, and this will be what I will leverage in the next part. And also very important, testing error is much more important than training error. Okay, so again, optimization is just a mean to an end. And what we care about is testing error. And sometimes what works well at training time may not be that important at testing time. Okay. So it might be a good moment to make a small break and get questions. So Anant. So maybe if you have questions, you can.
There is just one question so far. What would be the analog of L smooth in the non-convex setting?
Okay, so good question. So here, so in my slides, which I will put again, I've tried to be careful, and it's still. So here I've put like absolute values. Okay, so if you are convex, okay, so the eigenvalues are positive or non-negative, and they are bounded from above by L. So if you're just smooth, okay, you need to bound them from above and from below. Okay, so in anyway, any form of boundedness of your Hessians, like globally, is enough because all norms are equivalent anyway in finite dimension. So any norm would fine. So this is the operator norm, but any norm would be okay.
Yeah, okay. Somebody said on the slide of the proof of L by T convergence of function values on the third line, I think a parenthesis is missing.
Maybe. Agreed. I saw it. I saw it when I was giving the slide. I will correct it.
Yeah.
Can I also ask a question?
Of course, Maria.
Sure. I'm allowed to. I'm wondering a bit about practicality or implications of these ideas. So for example, if I invent now a new machine learning model, would you recommend to just check if the Hessian of that model or the Hessian of the loss function or typical loss function with this model now, what eigenvalue distribution that has? And I can already tell you, like, this is how it will train. So I'm asking because, for example, if we say like there's a certain distribution, can you really say like, okay, this is good or bad?
I think good point. Okay, so for some simple problems, you can compute L directly. If I give you a linear model, I give you the examples, okay? You compute the covariance matrix, and then you get L by just the largest eigenvalue of the covariance matrix. If you give me a more complex models, nobody will ever compute L, okay? Typically—
Well, you can numerically get a statistical sample of the eigenvalues,
yeah. Yeah, but the estimate will be so large and so pessimistic that this will become somewhat useless. This is what line searches are for. You need to know that there is some L, so the problem will be well behaved. But then the good algorithms will try to estimate the L on the fly when optimizing. Okay, so essentially, the L is there to make sure that you go down at every step. Okay, and line searching will typically make sure that to make a step size which is small enough to ensure local descent is typically what those line searches are doing.
But I'm not so much thinking inside the optimization algorithm, but just like I give you a model class or like a certain model, and then I just sample parameters and compute the Hessian of the cost function. And now I see an eigenvalue distribution. And I think I can do this even with large models to some
accuracy. You could, okay, but the issue is that, you need this to be valid uniformly over all parameters, okay? So you will not be able to sample all data. I think the issue is there. And the idea here is just they need to exist smoothness that you're sure you're converging correctly. But typically we don't compute the constants.
So Robert asks, how do natural gradients contrast relate to Newton methods?
That's a very good question. So I'm not going to cover this, but it is important. So let me go back to the slide. So the fact that the Newton method requires to compute the Hessian, okay, is a big issue, and you can replace by other matrices. Okay, you can choose to recondition the problem to make the condition number better. I think I should have mentioned it. So when you do this, okay, multiply by a matrix, so do Gaussian descent times some matrix like this, essentially this corresponds to changing the metric which you're looking at. So you change the metric, and hopefully if you change the metric, you're going to move to reshape the ellipses, and hopefully the ellipses will look like more like balls. Okay, and this is essentially what Newton method is doing. In the ideal way, but there are approximations where you can obtain similar reconditioning at much less expense. Okay, so natural gradient is one of them, and Adagra is one of them. So there are various ways of making the problem better conditioned. Okay, I forgot to add it. So this picture is important because this tells you how optimization is working, and it also tells you how you can make it work better. Okay, so make the problem better conditioned. And this is what batch norm is doing for neural networks a bit, and this is what natural gradient is doing as well.
So continuing to the same, like the same person, Robert asked further, what do you think of the Bayesian variational inference perspective like the one proposed by Imtiaz Khan?
Right. I think it's I think the trying to relate the so we have a finite sum, okay, so seeing the finite sum as a finite sum coming from ID data, so I think seeing this finite sum over there, okay, as essentially like a likelihood term plus regularizer and leveraging like Bayesian techniques, I think it's very good because they are things like Kalman filtering, which are made for that, and you can leverage the long literature on Kalman filters to get some good preconditioners. So I think very interesting.
So seems there are no more questions for now.
Okay. So let me try to re-share. Okay, can you see? Yeah. I hope you didn't hear that. I think yes. You did, that's okay. Okay, so can you see the slides correctly?
Yes.
So now let's go to the stochastic techniques. Okay, so I think for the next half hour, and I will not be able to finish probably, I'm going to go over so the stochastic gradient techniques, a little bit of two kinds, one for training error, one for testing error. All right, so again, the slide from before. So I want to minimize some finite sum, okay, like this. And each element of the finite sum, the finite average is fi of theta. And I'm going to optimize, so these two questions. If I'm minimizing this, I'm minimizing the training cost, but this is just a mean to an end. And I will also consider minimizing the testing cost, which is the expectation, okay, over data coming from the same distribution of the same loss. Okay, so this is really the one of the other. All right, so let's look at the finite sum first. So what is stochastic gradient descent? It's just go down the negative gradient, but not take the full gradient over there, just take one function taken at random. Okay, so by design, every iteration does not need to look at the entire data set, just look at a single function. So every step is O of D. Then the very common addition is to do averaging. It's called Polyak-Ruppert averaging, which is averaging on the side. Okay, so there's no interaction between this averaging and the iteration. It's called offline averaging. And of course, you don't need to store all iterations to do averaging. You can update the average easily. So what is known about that technique is that, so if you assume smoothness and some strong convexity, then you could show that the rate at which it is converging to the global optimum will depend on whether the function is strongly convex or not. Okay, again, you have some simple problems and some harder problems. And you have an expectation because your algorithm is randomized. Okay, so here at this point, here there is nothing random but my own randomization that I'm adding. Okay, so here I have functions. There's nothing random. Okay, at the moment, we don't do machine learning or statistics. We have functions which are given. The expectation comes from our own randomization, and this goes down to zero. Okay, in expectation, you also have results in high probability if you want. Goes down as 1 over root t if you are just convex. Okay, so this was 1 over t before, but it's 1 over root t, so it's slower. And if you're strongly convex, you remove this exponential dependence that you had before by just kappa over t. Okay, the condition number still appears, but now you lose exponential convergence. So you get like cheaper iterations, but probably a higher number of iterations. So very important, here we lose what I call adaptivity. So what I forgot to mention, what I mentioned gradient descent, and I will go back now because it's important, is that for gradient descent, those two rates, okay, are obtained with the exact same algorithm. You don't need to say to gradient descent, I think I had a hard problem, be careful. Okay, you just run the exact same algorithm. Okay, you do line search, a constant step size, and it will adapt. if the problem is hard, you're going to pay that price. But if you happen to be easy, and often closer to the optimum you get easier and easier, you can benefit from like good local strong convexity. Okay, so it's like super adaptive algorithm, and it's one of the reasons why it's so efficient, is that there's full adaptivity. If you do gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent over there, okay, then you lose this. You have to adapt the step size to the difficulty of the problem. So this is a huge problem, and this is related to the hardness of line search for stochastic gradients, okay, which is like a difficult problem. Then you have to adapt. You have to know in advance how you're going to be difficult, if you're going to be easy or hard. Okay, and now also the step size has to be decaying. Okay, and I will come back to that later. So now if you do the if you do epsilon equals kappa over t and invert the relationship, you get that t is kappa over epsilon, and now the running time complexity to reach precision epsilon is number of iterations kappa over epsilon times the complexity of every iteration, which is d times kappa over epsilon. Okay, so this is the usual like running time complexity of AGD. So here are the benefits. So you have lost the log of 1 over epsilon, which was transformed into 1 over epsilon. So if epsilon is 10 to the minus 6, this is going to be huge, but you lost the dependence in n. So if n is very large, it starts to be beneficial. But we can be more precise than this. Okay, and I think I want to highlight here the effect of averaging is that and the importance of the step size. Okay, so if you look at classical books, okay, on the stochastic gradient technique, in particular books from the last century, okay, 60s, 70s, 80s, then you would see all the best step size is 1 over t. Why? Because the sum of the step sizes is diverging, while the sum of the squares is converging. Okay, so this is typically 1 over t, and this is okay only for the well-conditioned problems. Okay, so if you have an easy problem, strongly convex, then indeed that 1 over t type of convergence is really what is preferred. But this is only true for those problems. And if you use 1 over t while the problem is not strongly convex, this will lead to huge slowdowns. Okay, so for modern problems, the step size that you should use is much bigger. Okay, and this is now, and now people even use like constant step size, which I will come back to later. But really, like a decay as 1 over t should not really be used unless you have a very precise ID of the strong convexity parameter. Okay, so if you add yourself the squared regularizer and you're convex, then using 1 over mu t, often called Pegasus, this is something which is totally fine. But if you apply this to some like neural network or some problems where you don't know the mu constant, then you have to find the mu, and this is very difficult. Okay, and this is what I want to convey in this slide, is that even for strongly convex objectives, the choice of C is very important. Okay, so this is somewhat open. And what you can show is that you can provide some detailed behavior of the impact of the step size. Okay, and in particular in terms of averaging. And so, and let me go to the born first. Is that the image to have when you do stochastic gradient is that you start from theta zero. Okay, so this is your initial point. This is where you want to go. Okay, and at every time step, you're going to follow the gradient plus some noise, okay, stochastic gradient, and which is quite an expectation, but you have some noise around the expectation. So you make some steps and you start to leave where you started from, and then you end up around the vicinity of your global optimum. Okay, so this is before averaging. So you leave where you start, and you get there. So all results which are precise should tell you two things: how fast you leave theta zero to enter the vicinity of the global optimum, and how those oscillations are being reduced. Okay, so to reduce the oscillations, you have two choices: you can lower the step size, make it decaying, or you can do averaging. Why? Because if you have like a sequence of iterates that are random and oscillates at the end, if you do averaging, you're going to lower those oscillations. Okay. So I think this image, I will come back to it later. I think it's quite important because this tells you that there are two components to stochastic gradient. Forgetting where you start from, it is very much aligned to deterministic optimization. In the deterministic setup, you just care to lose, to forget theta zero, go to theta star, okay? But when you do SGD, you have that part as well. But as soon as you go closer to the optimum, the fact that the gradient is stochastic, you have the oscillation at the end, okay? So bounds will typically be composed of the classical bound from deterministic optimization plus some additional term due to the loss. Okay, this is essentially what you see over there, where I've put in blue the dependence in initial conditions, okay, and in green, in red, the dependence of the noise. So here, sigma squared is the noise in the gradients, okay, the variance of the noise, and you see two terms, okay. So you first start by losing initial conditions exponentially fast if gamma is fast enough. And then you end up with a noise that will be bigger if you have a big step size. And if you do averaging, what you see appearing is that this forgetting of initial conditions will be much slower. It's always true. Whenever you do averaging, you're going to lose exponential dependence. Okay, you preserve convergence, but you lose exponential dependence. You typically get to 1/t². You lose there, but then what you can show is that the dependence of the noise is much, much better because you always get 1/t, whereas before you would get like a dependence on the step size. Okay, so the step size typically is between 1/t and 1/t. So this is significantly slower. So to make things like very simple, this is a simulation in 1D. Okay, so this is really non-big data, but I think this hammers the point. If you want to know more, Leon has a nice set of simulation. This has been confirmed by many people. Okay, I'm going to minimize the simplest function, okay, theta squared, where I add noise to the gradients. So here I'm considering on the left the step size 1/t, and on the right the step size one over t times some constant. I'm considering various constants in front of the step size, 1/5, 1 and 5. So it's not a big range, okay, only 5 between each. And I'm doing SGD without averaging in plane and in dotted with averaging. Okay. And for all of my plots throughout the talk, I will always have in the x-axis logarithmic number of iterations as often as a logarithmic scale, not always, and the distance to optimum, okay, almost always in logarithmic scale. Okay. So this is, I'm going to show several of those plots because this is what optimizers do, okay? They show plots of convergence like that. And so here, a few things to notice. So let's first take the, on the right, okay? So this is the old school, step sizes, 1/t times a constant. And what you can see is that if you choose C equal 1, okay? Whether you do averaging or not, this is a black curve, you do reasonably well. Okay, so this is like a best possible step size, in fact, C equals 1. But as soon as you take C too large, okay, you start by diverging. So it's really bad, okay? You start from a point and you start by diverging because you make steps which are too big. And because of the noise, you blow up everywhere. And then you recover and you end up with a nice convergence rate as 1/t. Okay, so we have a line here. It's a line in a log-log plot, hence it is, the slope is -1, you can check, so this is 1/t. And if you take C, which is too small, okay, I want to avoid this exponential blue thing at the beginning, so let's take C being small. And what you see like catastrophic behavior where you converge not anymore as 1/t, but as something very small, okay? And as you can see, in 1D, with just a factor of 5 on the step size, you get like very, very different behaviors. So imagine what's happening when you go in dimension like 1 million. It's going to be very difficult to set up the C like this, Okay, and this has been documented in many places. One over T should be forgotten unless you know what is C equals one. Okay, so if you know, if you have added yourself the regularizer, you know the best value of C, and that's fine. But unless you know this, is going to be an issue. Whereas if you start to do like a different step size, like one over root T, okay, so alpha being one half, similar things, you can see that this is before averaging over there. You see that first you're always in them converging, but the slope now is slower, it's not as steep, and this is essentially one over root T. Okay, so this is from the slide from before. I had the distance to optimum asymptotically will depend on the step size. So if the step size is one over root T, I get one over root T at the end. And you see the effect of C over there, okay? So if you get a bigger C, okay, you're a bit higher. And at the beginning, if I get a bigger C, like for alpha equals one, I'm going to blow up, okay? So I want to avoid having C which is too large. But now when I do averaging, okay, in a plane, in dotted, then all curves end up being aligned also in a minus one slope, okay? And you can now choose C with a bigger range. Okay, you can see here that, okay, we see like one or one over five is going to converge reasonably well. Okay, so in a sense, you increase the range of constants which you can use by doing a larger step size, and in the convex case, doing some averaging. Okay, so this is just to highlight the fact that even in 1D, you see things appearing. Okay, and so I really encourage you to at least run algorithms like that and see, make yourself SGD diverge, okay, and make yourself SGD too slow. I think it's a good exercise. But of course, 1D is really not enough. And now let's look at other things. And I will also only briefly mention like the new class of techniques, and I will come back to that. I will come back to them after the break. So now what we have seen so far, we have seen two types of techniques for minimizing finite sum. We have seen the batch gradient descent over there, which is a good on the negative gradient. Okay, so this is one aspect like this. So we have seen that this is converging linearly. Okay, so exponential of minus t over kappa in terms of distance to optimum, but every iteration is as a complexity which is linear in n. Why? Because you're going to compute the full gradient. At every time step, I will need to go through the entire data set, which is kind of slow. Okay, so the idea is that you get a few big steps. Then what we have seen a stochastic gradient descent where you're going to replace taking all functions by a single one taken at random. So by design, the iterative complexity is independent of n, but now you have replaced this exponential of minus t over kappa by simply kappa over t. Okay, so if you want to get to high precisions, like low epsilon, this is the problem. And the image to have is that you take a lot of small steps and you end up converging. So as a side note, the word SGD is the worst possible name for an algorithm which does not always descend. Okay, so sometimes to go up, if you do gradient descent with a sufficiently small step size, you will always go down, okay? But with SGD, sometimes you go up. So on average, you go down, but be careful. Sometimes it goes up, and often good values of the step size are values where the noise is appearing, and sometimes you go up. Okay, so this is like a big misnomer. All right, so what will be the goal for the next like 10 minutes and then the start after the break is, can we get the best of both worlds? Okay, so this is like in a fake plot. Okay, so always time in a non-logarithmic scale at the moment, distance to optimum in logarithmic scale, and I'm plotting the two types of algorithms which I presented so far. The deterministic one, so it looks like a line in a semi-log plot, so it's like linear convergence, but you see that there are some steps, some stairs. Why? Because when you do like deterministic gradient descent, you have to compute the whole gradient. So before you make a single step, you will need to compute all gradients. So for a while, you do nothing, you simply compute gradients. And once you have all gradients, you make a big step and boom, you get to something which is make lot of improvement and start again. Okay, you have some staircase effect. Whereas when you do SGD, as soon as you look at the first observation, then you make progress. Okay, so you make progress. And at the moment where the other has computed its full gradient, you're almost there. Okay, so and then you do a lot of progress at the beginning, but then you end up with this 1/T convergence rate. So you're going to, it's going to be slowed down a lot. Okay, so this means that you will never be able to go very, 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 very low. Okay, so if you want like high precisions, so low epsilon, then you will have to wait. You will have to wait forever. So the goal is trying to get the best of both worlds. So start as fast as stochastic, and end up with a linear slope, okay, linear convergence. This is one good thing. Second good thing, we want a simple choice of the step size, okay? A choice where you don't need to say to depend on mu and on 1/T, something simpler. And as a benefit, the slope will even be the slope there will even be very steeper. Okay, so for deterministic thing, we have seen that the slope is essentially condition number, and when the condition number is very large, so typically proportional to n, and n is 1 billion. Then that slope will not be like this, it will mostly be like this, okay? Very, 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 very slow, okay? And it turns out that with those like new techniques, we will be able to go even steeper. So then let me, of course, mention some related work on how to accelerate Gaussian techniques, because this has been like here for quite a while. And the most classical way of accelerating Gaussian descent is so-called Lester of acceleration, okay, often sometimes called momentum. Well, the idea is that you do some gradient step, but you add some momentum term where you keep on moving towards the same direction as you moved before. This is like the direction of the move from before, and this is you keep on moving to the same direction. Okay, so it's one line, it's like a two-line algorithm, like very small modification, and at least for the convex case, then if you properly choose the momentum term delta over there, then you can improve over the rates that we have seen before. Okay, so in the convex case, you go from 1/T to 1/T square. Okay, so this is an improvement because 1/T square is much bigger than 1/T. And if you are strongly convex, what you can show is that you replace the condition number by the square root of the condition number. Okay, so when the condition number is 1 billion, this is a very strong benefit. And so two comments. First, the improvements can be seen in practice. It's not only like some theoretical argument where you can't see it. You do see it in practice, and I'll come back to that tomorrow. And then those rates end up being optimal, okay, in the sense that if you want to minimize some convex or strongly convex function, you will not be able to improve over those rates. Okay, it's a very, very important result by Nesterov. Okay, so essentially, if you beat this, either Nesterov is incorrect or you're adding some extra assumptions. Okay, so what I will show probably tomorrow is that in the stochastic setup, we can improve on those rates by leveraging the fact that we have a finite sum. Those algorithms do not know that you have a finite sum, okay? But if you include this, you can improve. But the problem for us of Nesterov acceleration is that the iteration cost is still O of nd. You are not leveraging the finite sum, so you improve the dependence on kappa, which is very, very significant, but you keep the O of nd. Then there are other ways of accelerating gradient techniques. So the first classical idea is to use constant step size. Okay, so even like not 1/T, not 1/√T, but constant. So this is nice, but this will be not globally convergent. Okay, why? Because in my plot with the iterations going from theta zero to theta star, I still oscillate. Okay, so if I don't lower the step size, I will get quickly to the vicinity of my global optimum, but I will not converge. Other ways is to use like a stochastic techniques in the dual. Okay, so this requires to define a proper dual, but essentially the heights I'm going to achieve like in a moment can also be achieved by a randomized coordinate ascent in the dual. And finally, people have tried to combine the Nesterov acceleration with stochastic techniques. Okay, so essentially what they obtain is to get an improvement of the rate at which initial conditions are forgotten. Okay, but the impact of the noise remains for number T. Okay, so it's not helping to get exponential convergence. So let me now present the algorithm, the stochastic average gradient algorithm that we designed with Nicolas Leroux and Mark Schmidt in 2012. So the idea is that we're going to keep the memory of the gradients. Okay, we're going to select functions at random. Okay, every time step, select the function I of t at random, compute the gradient, and we're going to store that gradient. Okay, so this means that at every moment in time, we have stored values of each gradient, sometimes very new value, okay, because this is a value which I have just computed, but sometimes very old value. And in the slide, yit is a version of gradient I at time t that I have in my memory. And whenever I select a function I, I'm just replacing the memory by the new value, okay? So yit is the version of all of my gradients, okay, that I have in memory. And the step will simply take the average of all of those. Okay, so in a sense, I like to see as a super lazy gradient method where I have my n gradients and I'm only replacing one of them by a new one. Okay, and I keep all the other ones intact. Okay, and every time step, select a gradient, change one gradient only, keep the other ones from before and do a step. Okay, so the way it works, okay, same picture, I have my average of the functions, I have all of my functions, I have my average gradient. Of course, the algorithm will not recompute the full average. Okay, we'll update the average because if you update a single yi, okay, you update the average in a similar way. The way it works is that I take a function at random, f3, compute the gradient, replace, update my stored value, update the average, make a step, start again, random function, here f1, okay, then I update my stored value, so I compute the gradient, stochastic gradient, and then I update the y, et cetera, et cetera. So first aspect, this is not a new algorithm. Okay, so this is simply a stochastic version of what has been done before by Blatt and colleagues, which who were simply doing a cyclic version. Okay, so instead of taking each of them at random, okay, they will simply take the first one, then the second, then the third, then the fourth. Okay, so this is like, this looks like a very minor modification, but this makes the algorithm much faster. In a sense, the step size with randomization, and I come back to that tomorrow, can be much bigger, and gamma can be much bigger when you do randomization than when you do like cyclic. So as you can see, it's still like two lines of code. I was able to code it myself, so this means it has to be easy, but it has some memory requirements. Okay, as you can see, you have to store the gradients. Okay, so if you have n gradients in dimension d, this is going to be hard to store. But there are two fixes for that. There's an algorithm called SVRG that is available to avoid storage now. But if you do linear supervised learning, where I've shown that if this is my function fi, the gradient is proportional to the feature vector, I'm not going to store the whole vector. I can only store the constant, okay, which is O of n and not O of nd. And now, and this will be my last slide, okay, and I will make this more precise later tomorrow. And this is like a nice summary of what we have seen today. We have seen HGD, which dependence in the precision is 1 over epsilon, because I get a 1 over t convergence rate, times this condition number kappa. This is LGD, this is gradient descent. it is linearly convergent, so I get this log of 1 over epsilon, which is important to get to a small epsilon, but I get n times the condition number. So all the rates are multiplied by d, because d is the complexity of accessing a single gradient. Then if you do acceleration, you replace the condition number by the square root condition number. So you gain a lot there, but you still have times n. And what SAG can achieve is you replace the product of n times condition number by the sum. Okay? And if the condition number is of order n, which is like common in machine learning, you go from n squared to O of n. So this is quite significant. And I will skip and just show one slide, take the right slide. And what I was presenting as wishful thinking in a few slides ago ends up being what's happening. Okay, so I will come back to that tomorrow, that what we see in the bounds can also be seen in practice. So on this, I will stop and take questions on this part of the talk.
Yes, so, okay, I think this question you answered, but I'm by Remy. So his question was like, what are the drawbacks of Polyak-Rupert averaging? Does it suffer from a large bias, especially when the first iterates are bad, far away from optimal, or in a non-convex setting?
A very good question. So the typically, okay, so if I go back to my slides. So if you take that figure, okay. Yep, that figure. So if you average from the beginning, you're going to be slowed down because you keep on adding on the average the first iterations. Okay, so for that, so this is very, very bad. So what people do a lot is what we call tail averaging, is that you only average after a while. So you discard the first two iterations. Okay, so if you do typically multiple passes on the same data set, typically you just do this after a pass. You do a full pass, so you have lost data zero, you start to be in the vicinity of the global optimum, and you do averaging after a while. Okay, so this is the answer for removing the bias towards data zero. Then in the non-convex setting, so this is like a bit more difficult because averaging will do is to reduce oscillations if you oscillate around the same optimum. Okay, so in the non-convex setting, you may sometimes oscillate between various modes. Okay, so the average will get you between modes, which is kind of useless. So in the neural net setup, typically averaging is not done because it doesn't have as many benefits as for the convex case.
So the next question is Miko asks, can you improve the bounds by weighting non-uniformly in the averaging?
Oh, that's a very good question. So going back to the slide. So you can, if you're here, okay. So here, if you change the averaging, okay, and you put more weight on the later iterates, okay, then you're going to improve this. So if you replace the sum of the theta t over t, the sum of the theta t over capital T, and you replace this by sum of t theta t over capital T square, for example, then you're going to probably, if I remember correctly, replace t square over there by t3 or t4. Okay, so you can, if you put more weight on the later iterates, you improve this, but you're going to degrade this a bit. Okay, not so much, but you start to pay a bit here.
And then the next question by Remy again, the choice of C in the step size appears as a trade-off between fast convergence and slow oscillation. Yep. Large C has fast convergence, but large asymptotic variance. Is there any automatic way to select this parameter?
I think this remains. So there are many people trying to do it, but it's very hard to do in a robust way. Okay, and so the robust way I know so far is to have some validation sets. What people do in practice, okay, so you see it like you see the test error decaying, okay, and when it stops decaying, you lower C. Okay, so you take C like a constant step size and you lower. So this is if you always optimize the same cost function, then it's totally fine. And I think this is one like tension within optimization is that as optimizers, our goal is to optimize all functions of the universe. okay, and to be valid for all functions. But our colleagues from machine learning, okay, they want to optimize a single cost function. Okay, and for them, optimizing functions from signal processing, they don't really care. Okay, so you have to always this, you have to know what you want to do. So if you end up always minimizing the same type of functions, then designing heuristics that work well on those kinds of functions is totally valid. Okay, and reducing the step size after like a certain number of epochs is totally valid. But if you want to have something robust, okay, and this is where the when you invert a matrix in MATLAB or Python, you don't question the validity of the matrix inversion. Okay, so when you minimize convex functions, our aim is that we obtain similar stability and robustness. Okay, so you want this to work regardless of the funkiness of the function you optimize. So this is why it's important still to have like methods which are well adapted to any type of problem and not only like deep nets.
So there are two more questions. Shall we take it in the round table or?
No, I can take it now, fine.
So the one by Mrinank, the good choice of momentum term, how hard is it to find this term and how sensitive are the rates to this term?
This is quite sensitive. I think the in the convex case in particular, for techniques I'm going to present a bit later tomorrow, really you sell them from theory. Theory tells you that, oh, like delta should be one minus square root condition number minus one over square root condition number plus one. Okay, so this is the official delta. If you deviate from it, it may not improve a lot. Okay, and so either you do this if you're convex, and for the momentum terms, in if you do like non-convex LGD, typically it's trial and error. You try small values and until it starts not working anymore.
So Mirko had a question. In SAG, you could easily assume that the fixed order of the FI is already random. So the difference between SAG and the work by Blair TTL is not randomness, but rather sampling with replacement versus sampling without replacement.
I think this understanding is partially correct. In the sense that, so here we end up seeing functions many times, okay, but several times. So if I go back there, so at the end I'm going to make like the number of iterations will be bigger than n, so some function will be seen several times, okay, and so at the end. Indeed, you could randomize the order of the function FIs, but when you cycle, you do it several times. So one thing, this is why you're partially correct, is that you could also, it's often done in practice, you could replace full sampling with replacement by, in fact, first shuffling the data, do a cycle, reshuffle. So if you do those like reshuffling things, so random reshuffling things, you're getting closer to sampling with replacement, but still not as good.
I think that's all. Thank you very much, Francis, for the talk, and thanks to all the attendees as well. It was really great talk. So we see you again in like 10 to 15 minutes in the round table.
Okay, very good.
Perfect. Thank you.
All right. See you.
Bye-bye. See you.
Bye. Thank you very much.